we first of all would like to thank our co-sponsors, Sam Chesno. We want to give him a shout out from Student Leadership, and Ty Pethe. They really did a wonderful job for us, making sure you had the visuals so we could put this event in proper context. Tina Young, the Director of Multicultural Initiatives and Services, she was one of our supporters and allies, and of course, you students and other faculty members that thought this was a worthy event to bring the students to.
Thank you. So what I would like to share, just really briefly, is a statement prepared by our Teachers Union, Human and Civil Rights Committee, and our Executive Board, and all the faculty will be discussing it today. This statement is called, "We Oppose Anti-Muslim, Anti-Refugee Rhetoric." And it's very brief. It says, "The AFT Seattle Local 1789 of Seattle College District wishes to state publicly, the November 2015 repulsive and horrific terrorist attacks in Lebanon, France, and most recently Mali have been followed by a rise of anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim bigotry in the United States and the world media. These public statements create another form of terror as they contribute to an atmosphere of oppression and fear. As faculty, staff, and students of the Seattle College District, we recognize that one of our strengths as a community is our diversity and our commitment to an encouraging and educational work environment. We are proud of the fact that as faculty, staff, and students, we include immigrants, refugees, Muslims, and people of color. We are all attacked by the statements that confound Islam with terrorism or see all refugees and immigrants as dangerous. We urge all students, staff, and faculty to take a stand against these kinds of statements when and where they encounter them. Signed, the Faculty Union of Seattle District Colleges." Thank you.
Set the tone, okay? So I want to just give you a little heads up as to why we're here. We're here to give voice and give space to a movement that has definitely changed the trajectory of where we are in this country. We're here to support the UN resolution that was adopted by the General Assembly on December 23rd, 2013, that in essence says, what does it say? There it is. That says, reiterating that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights and have the potential to contribute constructively to the development and well-being of their societies, and that any doctrine of racial superiority is scientifically false, morally condemnable, socially unjust, and dangerous, and must be rejected, together with these theories that attempt to determine the existence of separate human races. The UN adopted a resolution on December 23rd, 2013, proclaiming International Decade for People of African Descent. Now this is really important because I recognize that some folks in here may not be down with the Black Lives Matter movement, and that's fine. We're not here for you to convince you to be down with that movement. But what we're really here to do is to tie in that movement with this proclamation that you all were given a copy of. And what the challenge is for you is, once Mara and Marissa is done, we're going to challenge you, all of you, Black, Brown, and others that are in this room, to find out what are you going to do for the next decade as students to move this resolution forward. Because this is a proclamation that says we need to exact justice for those Black and Brown brothers and sisters from the African diaspora that have been marginalized and living on the fringes for so many years. So we want to make sure you understand what this really is all about. We hope to have events monthly, mostly sponsored by students. While we're not here, we are not here to discuss Bernie Sanders. We're not here to discuss Hillary Clinton or any other politician. Okay? We are not here to be disrespectful or rude just because you may not agree with one's ideology. I challenge you all in this room, if someone should behave in a rude manner, I'm going to hold us all accountable for putting a stop to it right away. Okay? With that being said, I would like to introduce a former faculty member, retired faculty member, someone that had mentored me and actually is the very reason why I got involved in AFT Seattle. And her name is Marcella Pendergrass.
very important. I first encountered our guest speakers at the August 8th, 2015 rally at Westlake when they stole the spotlight from presidential candidate Bernie Sanders and exposed the underbelly of U.S. race relations for the world to see. I came away from that rally understanding that the failure of the civil rights movement was the failure of the activists in the 60s to organize the working class out of their racism and white supremacist delusion. In 1965, calls for black power scared many into inaction or reaction. 50 years later, in 2015, calls for Black Lives Matter is having the same effect on some. For others, however, it has been a wake-up call to creative, audacious, and improvisational action such as has not been seen in these states. A 20th century prophet, George Orwell, once said, "In a time of universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act." Brothers and sisters, this is a time of universal deceit. It is my honor and pleasure to introduce you to Seattle's own revolutionary truth. The activists that achieved results on the same day that they acted up. The organizers that raised me from the dead and restored my hope in the future. My own personal saviors, Mara and Marissa.
This is loud. I'll go ahead and introduce myself first. It's going to be weird because I'm going to be standing and Mara's going to be sitting because we have different tastes and we're not the same person. So, first, I just want to say thank you so much for having us here in this space. Thank you for Kim for, yes, roping us in and bringing us along and lots of email exchanges back and forth.
And
to
good food.
Yes, and good food. Yes, don't forget that. And to Marcella, because actually when we were at the Bernie action, she was a very key part of the action taking place, even though we didn't know she was going to be there. Because as we were up on stage doing what we felt like we needed to do, there was a sea of vitriol, of hate, of just pure, I don't know, there's a evil spirit in the air. And out of thousands of people yelling and screaming at us, I saw two people, one of whom's not here, that stood up and were making direct eye contact with us, two black people, and telling us to keep going. And Marcella was there with tears in her eyes, with her hand on her heart and her other fist in the air, looking at us. And I knew that she was praying for us. And that grounded me and centered me. So it's such a blessing and an honor to have her introduce us here today. My name is Marissa Johnson. I am no longer a Sarah Palin supporter. Disclaimer, I am a full-time nanny of toddler twins. By day, I try to follow Christ and I fail a lot. And I'm also a political agitator.
Marissa just kind of outlined our relationship to Kim and to Marcella and how they've been a really grounding force for us, especially at the Bernie rally itself. But I actually, when I speech, and then, and the crowd was like, okay, she's done. Now we can hear Bernie. And she looked at the crowd and she said, and now we're gonna have a 4.5 minute moment of silence for Michael Brown, because it was the day before the anniversary of his murder. And so that's really when the crowd got even more hostile, started throwing things, started screaming. And it really felt like being at a lunch counter. It really felt like what I would imagine people must have felt like when, you know, you have people spitting on you, you have people yelling, and you know that you can't. You went into that situation knowing that that would happen, and being making a conscious choice that you're going to make that sacrifice is very difficult. But when Marissa said we're going to have this 4.5 minute moment of silence, I knew we really were going to do it, no matter what, by any means, we were going to do it. And so I remember I said, hold my hand. And we were standing at the podium, and we held hands, and we did it 4.5 minutes, and it was, you know, one of the longest 4.5 minutes of my life, because we really were under attack. We really were in a very dangerous situation where people were yelling, drag them on stage, tase them, why haven't they been arrested yet? It's funny because I really did feel at peace the whole time because I had Marissa next to me, and that really did make the difference. And it's funny because people always assume that me and Marissa know each other really well, that we've known each other for a really long time, but we've actually only known each other for less than a year. But we've done so much together that there's a huge amount of faith that we've had in each other in those direct action situations that we've been in. A little bit about me. I was born and raised in Seattle. I went to Seattle Central and North Seattle Community College.
See, nannying twins will prepare you to do the wildest things.
Sorry, Brian.
Oh, yeah. So really quickly, we thought it would be a good idea. Me and Mar have had some fun in the last few weeks talking with students about our action, because apparently there's a lot to talk about. But what we're going to do right now is we think it's helpful for folks to just see the video to get a little bit of context, because there's everything that happened afterwards, but the video itself is pretty raw and emotional and provides a lot of context. So we thought we'd show a little bit of it here just to get our conversation started.
Bernie Sanders, I would like to welcome you to this place called Seattle, which is actually occupied Duwamish land.
Children.
unless we want to do a 4.5 minute moment of silence to a background of screaming, hollering folks.
Okay.
So I think. And even just hearing it now, it's like really hard to even stand up here in front of everybody and not just lose it because it's so triggering. The first time I heard that audio, I did an interview with This Week in Blackness, which is an independent black-owned media company out of Berkeley, California. And I did the interview, this actually was on a Saturday. I did that interview on a Monday. And they phoned me into the interview, and I didn't know they were going to be playing audio, just audio. I hadn't seen any video because I had cut myself off from media, but they were playing, they had phoned me in and were playing audio of those people screaming at us. And before I went and did my interview, I was just like crying because I was listening to it because it's so triggering. So I appreciate all of you guys being here with us to listen to it, but I think the experience of it.
All right.
There's a lot there.
Okay, so where we're going to go from here is we're going to have a facilitated interview with both Marla and Marissa, and John and I have some prepared questions, and you all will ask to fill out a note card, and if you have a question, write it down, and around 11:30, Anna will come around and pick up those questions from you, and then we'll have a Q&A period for Marla and Marissa, okay? So, John, do you have the first question you left there?
Yes, this was very powerful, so I'm glad everyone had a chance to watch the video. And I have, you heard Marissa speak, and she mentioned the lunch counters. I hope everyone understands the reference to the lunch counters. In the South, in Georgia, South Carolina, the Woolworths lunch counters, the Crest Company lunch counters, black people were not served, they were not wanted to sit with other people at those counters, so the young students, the black students from the black colleges sat in to challenge those traditions, challenge those laws, and face hostile and violent reaction from white people in those cities. But it broke the tradition and put the federal government on the spot, saying you must take action against these kinds of laws. Marissa gave us a tremendous history lesson here, and I think even a more powerful history lesson on stage, if you listen to her and what she said in order to orient Mr. Bernie Sanders' visit to the city of Seattle, which has a long history of discrimination and also violence against people of color. So I have a question. I have a question for Marissa and Mara, who I consider teachers, who I consider historians and activists and revolutionaries. Because we know that many people, like Marcella said, in the 60s, the civil rights movement didn't convince enough people about their supremacist views and privileges. But now we know that we have this opportunity, the movement's in the other direction. So my question for Marissa and Mara is, finally, after 50 years of struggle, is the genie out of the bottle? Is the genie out of the bottle? Is this the chance for America to push forward and challenge all these racist traditions and biases? And what can we do to push that even further?
I think in large part our action definitely in the weeks following our action, there was these very forced race conversations. I think, you know, this country for 40 or 50 years has really tried to have this colorblind post-racial analysis and way of framing things, sort of like, okay, we killed MLK, so now shut up, like, be happy and don't talk about race, don't talk about your experiences. And I think because the action was so controversial, all the news outlets were talking about it, and it really made it so that whether you were in your workplace or at the dinner table or at school, everyone was having these conversations where they were trying to make sense of our action. And by engaging in our action, whether you agreed with it or not, or whether you understood
scared or too repressed to have.
And I'll just jump in there real quickly and say that the struggle for Black folks has been way longer than 50 years. It has been forever since we were first forced here and enslaved. And that our struggle is not just here within the United States, it's a global one, a global struggle of anti-Blackness that's connected to how Black people and people of the African diaspora are enslaved, are murdered, are capitalized on for profit and for gain globally. So we connect all of those struggles together, but in terms of is this our opportunity to get at racism, I don't think it's about convincing people of that something's right. I think that capitalism has put us in a position, I was just writing about this tonight, where it is profitable to have white supremacy reign. White supremacy is profitable to capitalism. Anti-Blackness is profitable, right? And so in order to break through those systems, you have to make the cost of white supremacist violence too high. And no one knows this better, right, than the students at Mizzou. You cost the university $1 million and the president's salary is $500,000 a year, that's easy math via capitalism, right? Yeah. And so it's really not a conversation about changing hearts or whatever, as much as it's a conversation about what are going to be the repercussions for white supremacist violence, right? And so we told Bernie, the repercussions for your participation are, you lost your platform, we just stole it. And so I think the question is, are people going to be willing to put themselves out there on the line to start enacting consequences against our government, against our state, and against the powers that be, that make the cost of continuing Black genocide too high?
So my question is for you, you know, I participated on Friday, despite my doctor's advice, Black Lives Matter protest, you know, the boycott of Black Friday. And I was really, really intrigued about how many people were there. But one of the things that I was mindful of is I liked to hang around the police. You see, I wanted to hear what they were saying as things were moving on. And what I noticed was that they tended to be more managing the protest than the protest managing. And I say that because I would hear them say, block this off so they can't come this way, or block this off so they can't come that way. And I'm like, Or when they did allow you to go a certain space, they gave you, in essence, permission without you asking for it or them telling you so. And I was like, oh, this is intriguing here, right? So I say this because protests really do appear to bring in, you know, a lot of community support, including a lot of police support, right? Because the police are making a lot of money in overtime, which means the city of Seattle and other municipalities, they're using taxpayer dollars, particularly dollars from those that are being marginalized and oppressed, to continue to put funds in those that are, just because they're agents of a militarized state, the oppressor. So my question is, protests are great, but are there any other strategies that you think, and I think you hit on that, that the Black Lives Movement is considering? The Montgomery bus boycott was successful not because of moral issues, because the government cannot legislate morality. It doesn't work. It was successful because of the economics of it. And so how do we, or where's the movement going in regards to really looking at rolling boycotts or boycotting places like Amazon or Starbucks, those places that influence change? And giving the example of what's happening with the football team, that wouldn't have happened. It wasn't a moral issue. The president, the board of trustees didn't say, oh my gosh, these very awful things are happening to these colored kids. No, they said, oh my gosh, our ticket sales are sinking and you gotta go.
Yeah.
Here's a nice payout, but you're bad press. So we know money is the answer. And we also know Black folks, the dollar stays in the Black community for 15 minutes. 100 years ago, the dollar stayed in the Black community for 100 days. So we are contributors to our own oppression. So, my question to you is, what strategies are being discussed in the Black Lives Movement to move from the street of protest into some real shutdown?
I'll let you go first, since that kind of ties into what you're saying.
protest, that's something that you weigh when you decide to do an action. And so there was a lot of conversation about this about a year ago in Ferguson, where people were like, okay, we're doing these protests and people are getting arrested and we're paying bail and all that money is just going to the government and sitting there for, like, is this the best use of our dollars? And I don't think that it's either or, and I actually see the work that I do in terms of political agitation work as bolstering the work of other groups that are already established, that are already doing community service, providing services to the community. But in terms of, like, how much the city of Seattle spent, which I think it was $1.6 million or something for protests last, maybe it was more than that, for last winter on protests, it's like, are we spending that money? Yes, but do we have control over that money to begin with? Not black folks. So, I don't care, and I can tell you this, a lot of white folks were pissed about that money being spent too, and so I think when you're talking about, when I talk about having to have the cost of white supremacy be too high, I think we have to be really creative about how that happens, even if it does take a particular hit to us, because people will make that economic point, but not recognize the fact that black people in large don't, already don't have control over the how the government is pimping our money. And then I think secondarily, one, to bring Mizzou back into the case of how economics might be able to help us, it's really tricky because of the population percentage that black people account for in the U.S. Like, we actually can't do this alone. and especially the ways that we've been systematically oppressed and undercut and undergirded financially, even and had declined over the past several decades within black median incomes and things like that. I think one of the successes of Mizzou was they took an industry, right, where black folks are the main laborers in general, and were able to cut that out. So if college football teams were like 75% white, they can do nothing, but because they're majority black, which is why sports is gonna be a really interesting place for the movement moving forward, they were able to see that's where the majority of the laborers are. So that's not something that would work in every industry. So I think we have to be a lot more calculating and specific. Like, I think college sports and professional sports is a specific way for us to do that, but be really calculating on how can we get into those industries where black folks are the primary laborers and cut off that source of labor versus, like, how much we're spending. Because people are, in general, are spending money on things that they need to survive. We're already oppressed. And I think, secondarily, how do we get groups to come together in solidarity, right? Because it's not going to be able to be just black people because we don't account for enough of the population. Okay, what if we work with other groups and we all say we're going on strike or we're not working or whatever? And we saw a little bit of that happen here in Seattle, I think, with the teacher strike.
Okay, yeah.
I think
that's
it.
All right. Okay, do we have questions yet? So now that the Black Lives Matter movement has really taken the center stage nationally, and not just nationally, I mean universally, I mean the movement is everywhere. It's in Jerusalem, it's in Palestine, it's all over the world. You have, this movement has definitely affected change and an uprising around the world. My question to you young ladies, though, I was in Ghana, Africa when this all happened, and people was blowing up my phone, you know, and some folks was like, you know, at the time I was the president of AFT Seattle, and you know, I was only on the grid because in Ghana, you know, we have rolling blackouts minutes at a time. Well, what position is AFT Seattle going to take? And I'm like, well, what position should we take? And, you know, because a lot of our allies were offended. I wasn't. So I said, as president, I'm not going to take a position because then I would go probably against some of my members. So in that time in Africa, that I started looking at what was going on and trying to figure it out, and I was like, right on. They are rock stars to me. I love that. So where do you two go from here within the movement? You know, where do you go? What do you envision happening next for yourselves and for the movement? And what do these students need to do moving forward to help push this? Because you said that it's not just black people. It's all of us. It's all black and brown people that are oppressed. What do we need to do moving forward? And what challenges can we put forth to the students, to our administration, to our faculty, and to others to help push this agenda forward? Yeah.
Well, I think there's definitely been a tendency within this movement and really all social movements to sort of put certain leaders, label certain people as leaders and put them up on a pedestal and have certain expectations of them to sort of steer the movement or to speak for the movement. And there's not anything stopping an everyday person from making an extreme impact and changing lives. And I mean, we really had an effect on national discourse without having access to any resources, right? Like, all the work that we've done over the past year, like, we've never really spent any money on any of it. A lot of times we've had to do our actions without having a lot of structural support. And so I think that we've had to be really committed to, if we see that something needs to be done, we find a way to do it. Even if there's people that are like, you can't do that because you don't have access to this, or you can't do that because you won't be able to get in the building or whatever, like, we'll knock down the door. And we're not able to do that because we have any kind of, because there's anything special about us except for that. I think we own our own agency. In a world where people are really constantly have their agency taken away from them. And I think our partnership is one of the reasons why we're able to do that, because we're able to, when we have a lot of outside factors telling us no, we're able to say, no, we're gonna do this. So that's what we've done.
Yeah, I'll answer, as I think Mara was spot on in talking about, which is a whole other conversation, the expectations put on people who become visible in this work, particularly Black women. You know, people are, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? And there's so much noise, and there's a billion things you can do and a billion things you can't now. Like, I'm probably not gonna get a job at Amazon. You know, I know, shout out. No, but I think too, and I talked about this actually in an event a few months back, is I think people have such a desire to cling on to certain charismatic figures, that one thing that I've been really thinking about is the importance of cycling out people, and that there's a reason why it's the youth and it's the youngest people who are taking positions of visibility in this work and who are being innovative, is it's literally not sustainable to do the kind of work that we did long term. They will kill you if you don't die by your own hand first. And so I think there's a lot of pressure, at least, Mara can speak to this too, but for me, like, I think people want me to do Bernie Sanders type stuff, like, forever, and that would literally just kill me. And I don't think it's good for the movement, and so one thing that I'm really focusing on right now, like, I don't know if and when I'll be on the streets, but I wasn't at the Black Friday protest. I instead live tweeted it and prayed from home and things like that, understanding that your position changes as you get a lot of visibility. People assume that because you have a lot of visibility and people know your name and you're in the news, that it's a good thing, but it can be a distraction for a lot of things, and it can also be really dangerous for you. And so I've stepped back from some more high visibility work to thinking about, okay, I've spent the last year literally just learning so much and having experiences in grassroots movement that probably very few people in this country will have in this generation. What does it look like now for me to spend time with students, for me to spend time with other people who are where I was a year ago, 2 years ago, to talk to them about my experiences, talk to them about how I do my work, in hopes that some other people, some other leaders might rise up and take their moment and be able to train up new generations. And so I think it's really important that we have an understanding that some of the work that we do is kind of based on your life stage too. Right? Like, there's a certain reason why young people can do this work. Like, we don't have kids a lot of times, we don't have spouses or whatever. As you move on into different spaces in life, it's like, if you've got a job and a mortgage and people depend on you, you can't do the kind of action we did, because there's other people, you know what I'm saying? And so, thinking about always, I don't think it's necessarily as key, I don't think what needs to happen is that everybody needs to do the type of high visibility agitation work that I've done for the past year. What I think is more important and what I'm more focused on in the future is interacting with people, talking with people, teaching people, how do you do agitation work wherever you are at in your life stage and in your work? Are you always stirring up the pot to make certain changes? I'm more interested in that. And I am quite certain that there will be new leaders even after me that come and do things even more marvelous and groundbreaking than what we've done.
Right on.
So this first question starts off with a comment, says y'all are awesome. And it says, I've heard countless times that the Black Lives Matter movement has undone all of Martin Luther King Jr.'s work. I personally disagree, but what would you say if you heard this? Undone his work.
You mean what white people say his work was? Like, how do you hate somebody in their own time, assassinate them, and then afterwards you're cool with them? And think about the first thing that's used to weaponize against Black people resisting against their oppressors. MLK. I'm like, you don't know any Black people, you don't love any Black people, you don't know any Black because you don't care about Black folks, but yet you're an authority on MLK? And so I really side eye most people when they bring up MLK because usually it's done as a way to weaponize against Black folks and people haven't actually read Martin Luther King. And also, like, Martin Luther King's not Jesus for Black people. Like, we come from a very rich tradition of revolutionaries, right? And people who engaged in resistance work, many of those women, hello, who are doing work on the low. And so, I mean, I would question how that person is interpreting MLK's work, but also, yeah, maybe I am doing MLK's work, because clearly this is not, we have not reached the promised land. Right? And Martin Luther King is in the ground. And so you keep feeding me the success story that has ended with continued oppression of my people and all of our revolutionaries murdered within years of each other. So by God's grace, hopefully I am undoing the work of MLK.
Yeah, I think the framing of MLK's legacy, right, as opposed to, like, the legacy of Black movement work or the legacy of the civil rights movement, like, I think that really feeds into, like, why we focus on these leaders almost like they're celebrities, mm-hmm. right, when really you're talking about collective movements. Why do you have a fixation on one person, right? So I think that needs to be called into question, but also, I think there's a lot that you could critique about the civil rights movement. I think one of the major critiques that people generally have of the civil rights movement is that they were very focused on inclusion. And we see that, right? Like, we see your token Black staff in any institution you go to, right? We see the results of inclusion in that we have President Obama, right? So we kind of see how inclusion has not worked out for us. And there's this really popular saying that assimilation is not liberation. And so I think a lot of times people confuse the two and think that if you're being included into something, that's the same as having your own agency and your own political power. And being included in, having a seat at someone else's table is not the same. A lot of times I think we need to go in, flip the table over, set it on fire. So it's very, those are two very different things.
Thank you. So the second question I have here is, how do you see the Black Lives Matter movement connecting to a fight for equality in general, and is it a larger fight against capitalism? Yeah. How do you see the Black Lives Matter movement connecting to a fight for equality in general, and is it a larger fight against capitalism?
You keep looking at me like this. Well, I want to caution with this question the desire, I think, that I've seen for people to erase Black folks in conversations of capitalist struggles. And this is one of our main critiques, too, of Bernie Sanders. I know you said we weren't going to talk about him, but I'm going to talk about him. One of our main critiques is that a lot of his analysis pre his interaction with the base was pretty class reductionist in that
you know, he's talking about in very colorblind terms, this is all about wages and inequality or whatever. And it's like, even if you look historically at the United States and how capitalism has literally built this country, right? It's not just vague-ass capitalism. It's capitalism on stolen indigenous land via black bodies. And so if you don't understand blackness within the United States and globally defined, like, as the heart of capital and as the heart of the supply, then you're not actually going to be able to dismantle capitalism. And so I think, in other words, I'll say this. I don't think there's a world with a system that we've built where black people can get free and other people don't. We're, if black folks get free, everyone else will have already been free way long before that, right? And so I caution against that because a lot of times what I hear when people are like, and the other thing too, so I don't have people who say that because while folks are saying that, almost every single other movement that you see going on in terms of class warfare and people fighting inequality, black folks and black women are all up in that anyways, right? Like, so I'm side-eyeing the people who say that because I feel like a lot of it is a pushback and trying to erase blackness, right? And because people want a form of inclusion that I think to understand American capitalism and it globally, you have to have analysis of black bodies as always being property and profitable, specifically. So that would be my response.
Yeah, and I mean, just to add to that, I mean, I think that people kind of confuse the relationship between racism and anti-blackness and capitalism. Because anti-blackness is fundamental to and precedes capitalism and racism. And so I think a lot of times people don't realize that it's true that you can't have racism without capitalism, but you can't have capitalism without anti-blackness.
Thank you. Well, I think I'm going to say that we are just about out of time, but before you all leave, there's a couple of closing remarks. Thank you, Dr. Wakefield, for coming, and Dr. Sheila Lang, did she leave already? And Annette Stoker is AFT Seattle's president. Thank you for coming. There was something that was given to me as I re-entered the struggle, right? And it, for me, the struggle was resurrected here within the Seattle College District, right? But when I was pulled back in, I was trying to get out, like Scarface said, I was trying to get out, and they just pulled me back in. But when I got pulled back in, one of my greatest mentors gave me a poster that's hanging in my office, and it's a quote from Dante that says, "The hottest places in hell are reserved for those who, in the time of greatest moral crisis, maintain their neutrality." And we are in the time of the greatest moral crisis on this planet. We have two very polarizing, no matter where your politics are, presidential candidates that can rock this nation if either one of them get elected. So we are really at a crossroads in this nation, and I think we truly, truly need to pay attention, and we truly, truly need to get involved and get mobilized to really understand that there's repercussions either way, because if Bernie Sanders gets elected, you know, you got those extreme capitalists that's gonna lose their mind, right? And if that other one gets elected, then, you know, we just have an anarchist state, nation. So we're
which
really,
might be a good thing.
Which might be a good thing, because all great empires must fall. But I say that because I think, you know, we are in a moral crisis. And those of us in here that just want to maintain neutrality and believe we live in this utopia, I say you're usually the ones that go first, right? Marcella, right? So I wanted to make sure that you got it. And kept them on point.
of putting yourself out there is high, but it's so incredibly worth it. And so I want to encourage all of you, whether it be in small ways, in big ways, or whatever, to really stir things up. Because we all have to live in the world that we create, or that we let it be. So that's just my encouragement to you guys. Thanks.
Thank you.